terrific crowd on hand here at Earl Anthony's Dublin Bowl, and the great one himself joins us up here in the booth for a few frames. Earl, nice to have you with us.
Nice to be with you, Danny.
And I have to ask you a quick question. How in the world could you own this bowling center and a left-hander has never won a tournament here?
Maybe this year, though. Parker Bowen's bowling great.
Okay, he's the top seed.
Yeah, I like his chances. He's really throwing the ball well.
And he led by almost 300 pins, and he's ready for a victory, too. It's been a couple of years since he's won. Meanwhile, Dave Traber, who opened with 255, throws a pretty good shot, leaves a four-pin.
They're tripping when you're 50 pins ahead. When you start the next match even, sometimes those four pins don't fall so easy.
Earl, do you remember any particular characteristics of this pair of lanes or this bowling center? How did you ever bowl when you were here?
Well, I'll tell you what, I used to come back off the tour and bowl in the scratch league we had here, which is a very strong league, and I was about 10th in average.
Wow.
I couldn't beat the guys here in the home house, but this particular end of the bowling center is normally the high scoring end. But of course, this is a PBA lane condition, so they're bowling on a lot different oil pattern than we bowled on in our leagues.
Well, speaking of high scoring, this man has averaged 258 on this pair, so he evidently likes it.
Well, he hasn't shot many spares in, right?
If he throws it like that, he'll continue to shoot a few spares.
I like his game. It's real solid. His balance is good at the foul line. He gets the ball well out in front of him. Those long arms help a lot.
You know, you mentioned you like his game. I said the same thing last night. I haven't seen too much of Mark Turney over the last couple of years, but Mike Durbin said he's the kind of guy that is not getting a lot of respect in terms of exposure, but he's a wonderful player.
And he's an up-and-coming player. He made a telecast earlier this year in Cleveland, won two games. He beat Dave Ferraro and Del Ballard, two pretty good bowlers, before he finally lost to Steve Cook, who went on to win the tournament.
Got a good shot. I'll tell you one thing I like right now is the reaction of the bowling ball.
The lane condition is excellent. It's conducive to high scores, as it's been all week, and here's another look at his game from the side. And as you can see, watch the good extension, the good balance of the foul line, how well he gets the ball out in front, and he chases it with his hand. That's what creates that real strong rotation and the good back end. He's got very good fundamentals. Don't you agree, Mike?
Well, what I liked was how far the ball went down the lane before it started making a turn. When it made a turn to the pocket, it was just like sucked into the 1-3 hole.
A lot of energy on the ball.
I have a physical question for you guys. If we get a strike here and we don't, with the longer arms, does that give you a tendency to get the ball down the lane easier, further?
I think you create a longer flat spot at the bottom of the swing, and I think that's very important for direction. What it gives you is more direction and more time to keep your fingers in the ball after your thumb is released. So you get direction and more hit in the back end, and that's a big advantage.
So for Traber, first look at a 10-pin here in the championship round. Started with the first six strikes as he disposed of Scott Devers in game number one, 255 to 188. So tell us what you've been up to, Earl. I know that you've been playing some golf.
I've been playing a lot of golf, Danny. We have a new club up in Oregon where I live, 36 holes, Pumpkin Ridge, and it's an excellent facility. I feel the best in the Northwest, if not the best in the West Coast. And I'm really looking forward for the other 18 to open up and you guys come up and play some golf with me.
You
got to give me about four a side, I think, and Mike and I will play even.
Yeah, this spoken by a four handicapper, right, yeah.
Notice how he nudged you right into that deal, Mike. Didn't want to leave you out. Well, you know, the other thing that's interesting, too, now you look at these two players, and I'll throw this out to both of you guys. One guy is probably crossing 20 boards and striking, and then you look at Traber, who is probably cutting that in half, 10 boards, and he's doing nothing but hit the pocket.
And, Mike, I think that's the pattern of dressing on the lanes. It's what you might call a Christmas tree effect, and what that does is put a lot of oil in the first 15 feet, and then it's tapered down toward the head pin. And when that happens, you can play anywhere on the lane based on your game. What you do is pick what feels best for you for your game.
Ooh, the rollout shot left the 4-9. Did you see that ball just roll out of the pocket? Still left the 4-9. What I think it speaks of, though, Denny, also, is it's a tribute to the PBA lane maintenance crew, that guys that throw the ball so extremely different can both score and be competitive, have a chance to win the tournament.
Yeah, if you take a look at the top five, Parker Bowen, he's got to be considered a power stroke type player. He crosses a lot of boards, and Scotty Devers doesn't much at all on the left side. Okay.
So you have a big variety there, even on the left side. Mm-hmm. So.
Mike, you mentioned something interesting as Turney cannot convert to 4-9. You said that the PBA has changed its philosophy in terms of what it does on television day with a pair of lanes, especially the last 15 feet.
Well, what the PBA is trying to do is to give the players a scoring environment on the television show, and there was a little trouble earlier this year, so they cleaned the last 15 feet of the lanes about 15 minutes before airtime. And what happens is that all the carry down that the ball uses during that time has happened at that point in time, and the guys have a pretty even reaction for the telecast, and you give these guys that kind of reaction, they're going to score.
Well,
Nice comeback shot for Turney, who obviously has to be a little bit upset with the fact that he left the 4-9 on a shot that he probably felt was pretty good.
Well, it was pretty good. He just got a terrible bad break.
Traber, meanwhile, goes back to work on a strike, leading by 5, so a double here puts him up by 15.
And the old unwritten rule on the PBA Tour, when your opponent opens, the other guy comes back and doubles. Just like that.
Earl's nodding. You did that to a few players in your time, didn't you?
And I've had it done to me many times also, Danny. Yeah.
He never opened. What are you talking about?
Yeah, you've seen the other side of that, haven't you?
I have. I've seen it a lot of times. And Mike said it well. It's almost like an unwritten rule. If you make a mistake, they jump on you. You can expect it. You do expect it. You just feel you just lost not only the open, but maybe another 20 pins.
Of course, for those of you who don't realize this, too, this is not the only bowling center that you own, right, Earl?
Danville, just about 10 miles up the road, 24-laner. And we have a tournament like this going here. We just put our bowlers up at Danville, and they're happy, and we're happy.
Oh, that works out nice. So Traber comes back. Very solid professional game at this point in time. Now let's see if Turney can wrestle some of that momentum back.
He's got to. Right now, you know, he was cruising along, even though it was only the third frame. But now he's almost in a must-strike situation because Traber is really locked in.
It'll be interesting to see if he makes any kind of an adjustment or if he feels he made a bad shot there.
All right, key question for both of you guys. What's the difference between a flush hit like that and a 4-9 or a 6-8 in your case, Earl?
Well, to me, the ball is rolling equally well in both shots. One, you're just a hair short at the point of release, and it makes the ball finish high in the pocket. Ball's cutting through when you make that kind of a split.
It's just, you're talking maybe a half inch at 60 feet, Denny. It's just so minute. They're both good shots, and one's just a bad break.
Turney could cut the lead back to 5. If he strikes here.
Stroke that pretty.
Set up again.
Shot. All right, Earl, thanks for stopping by and spending a little time with us. And what we want to do is take one look back to the final shots of your illustrious career. And just like Ted Williams, who had a home run in his last trip, you had to go out with a strike. WIBC Vice President Elaine Hagan was on hand a little earlier today here at Earl's Dublin Bowl to present him with a marvelous plaque because Earl is the BVL Honorary Co-Chairman. And Earl, his role with BVL has been one of great success. He's helped that program out considerably as he travels to VA hospitals throughout the country and gave away some bowling balls this past year and helped the VA vets with their bowling game, spent some time with them. And it's people like Earl that really you can count on in situations like that.
Well, I think Earl's learned something, some people learn early in their lives and other people learn later in their lives is giving back, whether it's to the community, to your church, to your family, to your sport, to your job, that there is a principle there that we need to learn. You got to give back.